Arsène Lupin versus Sherlock Holmes, originally released as Arsène Lupin versus Herlock Sholmes by Maurice Leblanc, translated from the French by George Moorhead, 1910. Publisher's note. The author, Maurice Leblanc, originally had his gentleman burglar face off against the inestimable Sherlock Holmes. Due to copyright issues, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle requested Leblanc to modify the name of the famous detective. Now that the copyright of Sherlock Holmes has long since expired, we are pleased to present this book in the way the author originally intended. And so the name of Sherlock Holmes will appear instead of Herlock Sholmes, and Watson will take the place of Wilson. Again, this is simply done in an effort to honor the author's original intentions. Chapter 1. Lottery Ticket Number 514. On the 8th day of last December, Monsieur Gerbois, professor of mathematics at the College of Versailles, while rummaging in an old curiosity shop, unearthed a small mahogany writing desk, which pleased him very much on account of the multiplicity of its drawers. "Just the thing for Suzanne's birthday present," thought he. And as he always tried to furnish some simple pleasures for his daughter, consistent with his modest income, he inquired the price, and after some keen bargaining, purchased it for 65 francs. As he was giving his address to the shopkeeper, a young man, dressed with elegance and taste, who had been exploring the stock of antiques, caught sight of the writing desk, and immediately inquired its price.
"It is sold," replied the shopkeeper.
"Ah, to this gentleman, I presume?" Monsieur Gerbois bowed, and left the store, quite proud to be the possessor of an article which had attracted the attention of a gentleman of quality. But he had not taken a dozen steps in the street when he was overtaken by the young man, who, hat in hand, and in a tone of perfect courtesy, thus addressed him. "I beg your pardon, monsieur. I am going to ask you a question that you may deem impertinent. It is this. Did you have any special object in view when you bought that writing desk?"
"No, I came across it by chance, and it struck my fancy."
"But you do not care for it particularly?"
"Oh, I shall keep it, that is all."
"Because it is an antique, perhaps?"
"No, because it is convenient," declared Monsieur Gerbois.
"In that case, would you consent to exchange it for another desk that would be quite as convenient and in better condition?"
"Oh, this one is in good condition, and I see no object in making an exchange."
"But..." Monsieur Gerbois is a man of irritable disposition and hasty temper, so he replied testily,
"I beg of you, monsieur, do not insist."
But the young man firmly held his ground. "I don't know how much you paid for it, monsieur, but I offer you double."
"No!"
"Three times the amount."
"Oh, that will do," exclaimed the professor impatiently. "I don't wish to sell it."
The young man stared at him for a moment in a manner that Monsieur Gerbois would not readily forget, then turned and walked rapidly away. An hour later, the desk was delivered at the professor's house on Viroflay Road. He called his daughter and said,
"Here is something for you, Suzanne, provided you like it."
Suzanne was a pretty girl, with a gay and affectionate nature. She threw her arms around her father's neck and kissed him rapturously. To her, the desk had all the semblance of a royal gift. That evening, assisted by Hortense, the servant, she placed the desk in her room. Then she dusted it, cleaned the drawers and pigeonholes, and carefully arranged within it her papers, writing material, correspondence, a collection of postcards, and some souvenirs of her cousin Philippe that she kept in secret. Next morning, at 7:30, Monsieur Gerbois went to the college. At 10 o'clock, in pursuance with her usual custom, Suzanne went to meet him, and it was a great pleasure for him to see her slender figure and childish smile waiting for him at the college gate. They returned home together.
"And your writing desk, how is it this morning?"
"Marvelous."
Hortense and I have polished the brass mountings until they look like gold.
So you are pleased with it?
Pleased with it? Why, I don't see how I managed to get on without it for such a long time.
As they were walking up the pathway to the house, Monsieur Gerbois said,
Shall we go and take a look at it before breakfast?
Oh, yes, that's a splendid idea.
She ascended the stairs ahead of her father, but on arriving at the door of her room, she uttered a cry of surprise and dismay.
What's the matter?
Stammered Monsieur Gerbois.
The writing desk is gone!
When the police were called in, they were astonished at the admirable simplicity of the means employed by the thief. During Suzanne's absence, the servant had gone to market, and while the house was thus left unguarded, a drayman, wearing a badge, some of the neighbors saw it, stopped his cart in front of the house and rang twice. Not knowing that Hortense was absent, the neighbors were not suspicious. Consequently, the man carried on his work in peace and tranquility. Apart from the desk, not a thing in the house had been disturbed. Even Suzanne's purse, which had been left upon the writing desk, was found upon an adjacent table with its contents untouched. It was obvious that the thief had come with a set purpose, which rendered the crime even more mysterious. Because why did he assume so great a risk for such a trifling object? The only clue the professor could furnish was the strange incident of the preceding evening. He declared,
The young man was greatly provoked at my refusal, and I had an idea that he threatened me as he went away.
But the clue was a vague one. The shopkeeper could not throw any light on the affair. He did not know either of the gentlemen. As to the desk itself, he had purchased it for 40 francs at an executor's sale at Chevreuse, and believed he had resold it at its fair value. The police investigation disclosed nothing more. But Monsieur Gerbois entertained the idea that he had suffered an enormous loss. There must have been a fortune concealed in a secret drawer, and that was the reason the young man had resorted to crime.
My poor father, what would we have done with that fortune? Asked Suzanne.
My child, with such a fortune you could make a most advantageous marriage.
Suzanne sighed bitterly. Her aspirations soared no higher than her cousin Philippe, who was indeed a most deplorable object, and life in the little house at Versailles was not so happy and contented as of yore. 2 months passed away. Then came a succession of startling events, a strange blending of good luck and dire misfortune. On the first day of February, at 5:30, Monsieur Gerbois entered the house, carrying an evening paper, took a seat, put on his spectacles, and commenced to read. As politics did not interest him, he turned to the inside of the paper. Immediately his attention was attracted by an article entitled Third Drawing of the Press Association Lottery. Number 514, Series 23, draws a million. The newspaper slipped from his fingers. The walls swam before his eyes, and his heart ceased to beat. He held number 514, Series 23. He had purchased it from a friend to oblige him without any thought of success, and behold, it was the lucky number. Quickly he took out his memorandum book. Yes, he was quite right. The number 514, Series 23 was written there, on the inside of the cover. But the ticket? He rushed to his desk to find the envelope box in which he had placed the precious ticket. But the box was not there, and it suddenly occurred to him that it had not been there for several weeks. He heard footsteps on the gravel walk leading from the street. He called,
Suzanne! Suzanne!
She was returning from a walk. He entered hastily. He stammered in a choking voice,
Suzanne! The box! The box of envelopes!
What box?
The one I bought at the Louvre. One Saturday, it was at the end of that table.
Don't you remember, Father? We put all those things away together.
When?
The evening, you know, the same evening.
But where? Tell me quick, where?
Where? In the writing desk.
In the writing desk? That was stolen? Yes. Oh, mon Dieu. In the stolen desk.
He uttered the last sentence in a low voice, in a sort of stupor. Then he seized her hand, and in a still lower voice, he said,
It contained a million, my child.
Oh, father, why didn't you tell me? She murmured naively.
A million, he repeated. It contained the ticket that drew the grand prize in the press lottery.
The colossal proportions of the disaster overwhelmed them, and for a long time they maintained a silence that they feared to break. At last, Suzanne said,
But, father, they will pay you just the same.
How? On what proof?
Must you have proof?
Of course.
And you haven't any?
It was in the box.
In the box that has disappeared?
Yes. And now the thief will get the money.
Oh, that would be terrible, father. You must prevent it.
For a moment he was silent. Then in an outburst of energy, he leaped up, stamped on the floor, and exclaimed,
No, no, he shall not have that million. He shall not have it. Why should he have it? Ah, clever as he is, he can do nothing. If he goes to claim the money, they will arrest him. Ah, now, we will see, my fine fellow.
What will you do, father?
Defend our just rights, whatever happens, and we will succeed. The million francs belongs to me, and I intend to have them.
A few minutes later, he sent this telegram. Governor Crédit Foncier, Rue Capucine, Paris.
Am holder of number 514, series 23. Oppose by all legal means any other claimant. Gerbois.
Almost at the same moment, the Crédit Foncier received the following telegram. Number 514, series 23, is in my possession. Arsène Lupin.
Every time I undertake to relate one of the many extraordinary adventures that mark the life of Arsène Lupin, I experience a feeling of embarrassment, as it seems to me that the most commonplace of those adventures is already well known to my readers. In fact, there is not a movement of our national thief, as he has been so aptly described, that has not been given the widest publicity, not an exploit that has not been studied in all its phases, not an action that has not been discussed with that peculiarity usually reserved for the recital of heroic deeds. For instance, who does not know the strange history of the Blonde Lady, with those curious episodes which were proclaimed by the newspapers with heavy black headlines as follows, Lottery Ticket Number 514, The Crime on the Avenue Henri Martin, The Blue Diamond. The interest created by the intervention of the celebrated English detective Sherlock Holmes. The excitement aroused by the various vicissitudes which marked the struggle between those famous artists. And what a commotion on the boulevards, the day on which the newsboys announced Arrest of Arsène Lupin. My excuse for repeating these stories at this time is the fact that I produced the key to the enigma. Those adventures have always been enveloped in a certain degree of obscurity, which I now remove. I reproduce old newspaper articles. I relate old-time interviews. I present ancient letters. But I have arranged and classified all that material and reduced it to the exact truth. My collaborators in this work have been Arsène Lupin himself and also the ineffable Watson, the friend and confidant of Sherlock Holmes. Everyone will recall the tremendous burst of laughter which greeted the publication of those two telegrams. The name Arsène Lupin was in itself a stimulus to curiosity, a promise of amusement for the gallery. And in this case, the gallery means the entire world. An investigation was immediately commenced by the Crédit Foncier, which established these facts. That ticket number 514, series 23, had been sold by the Versailles branch office of the lottery to an artillery officer named Bessie, who was afterward killed by a fall from his horse.
Sometime before his death, he informed some of his comrades that he had transferred his ticket to a friend.
"And I am that friend," affirmed Monsieur Gerbois.
"Prove it,"
replied the governor of the Crédit Foncier.
"Of course I can prove it. 20 people can tell you that I was an intimate friend of Monsieur Bessy, and that we frequently met at the Café de la Place d'Armes. It was there one day I purchased the ticket from him for 20 francs, simply as an accommodation to him."
"Have you any witnesses to that transaction?"
"No."
"Well, how do you expect to prove it?"
"By a letter he wrote to me."
"What letter?"
"A letter that was pinned to the ticket."
"Produce it."
"It was stolen at the same time as the ticket."
"Well, you must find it." It was soon learned that Arsène Lupin had the letter. A short paragraph appeared in the Echo de France, which has the honour to be his official organ, and of which it is said he is one of the principal shareholders. The paragraph announced that Arsène Lupin had placed in the hands of Monsieur Detinan, his advocate and legal adviser, the letter that Monsieur Bessy had written to him personally. This announcement provoked an outburst of laughter. Arsène Lupin had engaged a lawyer. Arsène Lupin, conforming to the rules and customs of modern society, had appointed a legal representative in the person of a well-known member of the Parisian bar. Monsieur Detinan had never enjoyed the pleasure of meeting Arsène Lupin, a fact he deeply regretted, but he had actually been retained by that mysterious gentleman and felt greatly honoured by the choice. He was prepared to defend the interests of his client to the best of his ability. He was pleased, even proud, to exhibit the letter of Monsieur Bessy, but although it proved the transfer of the ticket, it did not mention the name of the purchaser. It was simply addressed to "My dear friend." "My dear friend, that is I," added Arsène Lupin in a note attached to Monsieur Bessy's letter. "And the best proof of that fact is that I hold the letter." The swarm of reporters immediately rushed to see Monsieur Gerbois, who could only repeat, "My dear friend, that is I. Arsène Lupin stole the letter with the lottery ticket." "Let him prove it," retorted Lupin to the reporters.
"He must have done it, because he stole the writing desk," exclaimed Monsieur Gerbois before the same reporters.
"Let him prove it," replied Lupin. Such was the entertaining comedy enacted by the two claimants of ticket number 514, and the calm demeanour of Arsène Lupin contrasted strangely with the nervous perturbation of poor Monsieur Gerbois. The newspapers were filled with the lamentations of that unhappy man. He announced his misfortune with pathetic candour.
"Understand, gentlemen, it was Suzanne's dowry that the rascal stole. Personally, I don't care a straw for it. But for Suzanne, just think of it. A whole million, 10 times 100,000 francs. I knew very well that the desk contained a treasure."
It was in vain to tell him that his adversary, when stealing the desk, was unaware that the lottery ticket was in it, and that in any event he could not foresee that the ticket would draw the grand prize. He would reply,
"Nonsense, of course he knew it, else why would he take the trouble to steal a poor, miserable desk?"
"For some unknown reason, but certainly not for a small scrap of paper, which was then worth only 20 francs.
1,000,000 francs! He knew it. He knows everything. You do not know him, the scoundrel! He hasn't robbed you of 1,000,000 francs!"
The controversy would have lasted for a much longer time, but on the 12th day, Monsieur Gerbois received from Arsène Lupin a letter, marked confidential, which read as follows. "Monsieur, the gallery is being amused at our expense. Do you not think it is time for us to be serious? The situation is this. I possess a ticket to which I have no legal right, and you have the legal right to a ticket you do not possess. Neither of us can do anything. You will not relinquish your rights to me. I will not deliver the ticket to you. Now, what is to be done? I see only one way out of the difficulty. Let us divide the spoils, 500,000 for you, 500,000 for me. Is not that a fair division?
In my opinion, it is an equitable solution, and an immediate one. I will give you 3 days' time to consider the proposition. On Thursday morning I shall expect to read in the personal column of the Echo de France a discreet message addressed to Monsieur Arsène Lupin, addressing, in veiled terms, your consent to my offer. By so doing, you will recover immediate possession of the ticket, then you can collect the money, and send me 500,000 in a manner that I will describe to you later. In case of your refusal, I shall resort to other measures to accomplish the same result. But apart from the very serious annoyances that such obstinacy on your part will cause you, it will cost you 25,000 francs for supplementary expenses. Believe me, monsieur, I remain your devoted servant, Arsène Lupin. In a fit of exasperation, Monsieur Gerbois committed the grave mistake of showing that letter and allowing a copy of it to be taken. His indignation overcame his discretion.
"Nothing! He shall have nothing!" he exclaimed before a crowd of reporters. "To divide my property with him? Never! Let him tear up the ticket if he wishes."
"Yet 500,000 francs is better than nothing."
"That is not the question. It is a question of my just right, and that right I will establish before the courts."
"What? Attack Arsène Lupin? That would be amusing."
"No. But the Crédit Foncier, they must pay me the 1,000,000 francs.
"Without producing the ticket, or at least without proving that you bought it?"
"That proof exists, since Arsène Lupin admits that he stole the writing desk."
"But would the word of Arsène Lupin carry any weight with the court?"
"No matter. I will fight it out."
The gallery shouted with glee. The wagers were freely made upon the result, with the odds in favor of Lupin. On the following Thursday, the personal column in the Echo de France was eagerly perused by the expectant public. But it contained nothing addressed to Monsieur Arsène Lupin. Monsieur Gerbois had not replied to Arsène Lupin's letter. That was the declaration of war. That evening, the newspapers announced the abduction of Mademoiselle Suzanne Gerbois. The most entertaining feature in what might be called the Arsène Lupin dramas is the comic attitude displayed by the Parisian police. Arsène Lupin talks, plans, writes, commands, threatens, and executes as if the police did not exist. They never figure in his calculations. And yet the police do their utmost. But what can they do against such a foe that scorns and ignores them? Suzanne had left the house at 9:40. Such was the testimony of the servant. On leaving the college, at 9:05, her father did not find her at the place she was accustomed to wait for him. Consequently, whatever had happened must have occurred during the course of Suzanne's walk from the house to the college. Two neighbors had met her about 300 yards from the house. A lady had seen, on the avenue, a young girl corresponding to Suzanne's description. No one else had seen her. Inquiries were made in all directions. The employees of the railways and streetcar lines were questioned, but none of them had seen anything of the missing girl. However, at Ville d'Avray, they found a shopkeeper who had furnished gasoline to an automobile that had come from Paris on the day of the abduction. It was occupied by a blonde woman, extremely blonde, said the witness. An hour later, the automobile again passed through Ville d'Avray on its way from Versailles to Paris. The shopkeeper declared that the automobile now contained a second woman who was heavily veiled. No doubt it was Suzanne Gerbois. The abduction must have taken place in broad daylight on a frequented street in the very heart of the town. How? And at what spot? Not a cry was heard, not a suspicious action had been seen. The shopkeeper described the automobile as a royal blue limousine of 24 horsepower made by the firm of Peugeot and Company. Inquiries were then made at the Grand Garage, managed by Madame Bobvaltor, who made a specialty of abductions by automobile. It was learned that she had rented a Peugeot limousine on that day to a blonde woman, whom she had never seen before, nor since. Who was the chauffeur?
A young man named Ernest, whom I had engaged only the day before. He came well recommended.
Is he here now?
No, he brought back the machine, but I haven't seen him since,
said Madame Bob Valtor. Do you know where we can find him?
You might see the people who recommended him to me. Here are the names.
Upon inquiry, it was learned that none of these people knew the man called Ernest. The recommendations were forged. Such was the fate of every clue followed by the police. It ended nowhere. The mystery remained unsolved. Monsieur Gerbois had not the strength or courage to wage such an unequal battle. The disappearance of his daughter crushed him. He capitulated to the enemy. In short, an announcement in the Echo de France proclaimed his unconditional surrender. 2 days later, Monsieur Gerbois visited the office of the Crédit Foncier and handed lottery ticket number 514, series 23, to the governor, who exclaimed with surprise,
"Ah, you have it! He has returned it to you!"
"It was mislaid, that was all," replied Monsieur Gerbois.
"But you pretended that it had been stolen."
"At first I thought it had, but here it is."
"We will require some evidence to establish your right to the ticket."
"Will the letter of the purchaser, Monsieur Bessie, be sufficient?"
"Yes, that will do."
"Here it is,"
said Monsieur Gerbois, producing the letter.
"Very well. Leave these papers with us. The rules of the lottery allow us 15 days' time to investigate your claim. I will let you know when to call for your money. I presume you desire, as much as I do, that this affair should be closed without further publicity?"
"Quite so."
Monsieur Gerbois and the governor henceforth maintained a discreet silence. But the secret was revealed in some way, for it was soon commonly known that Arsène Lupin had returned the lottery ticket to Monsieur Gerbois. The public received the news with astonishment and admiration. Certainly he was a bold gamester, who thus threw upon the table a trump card of such importance as the precious ticket. But it was true, he still retained a trump card of equal importance. However, if the young girl should escape, if the hostage held by Arsène Lupin should be rescued? The police thought they had discovered the weak spot of the enemy, and now redoubled their efforts. Arsène Lupin, disarmed by his own act, crushed by the wheels of his own machination, deprived of every sou of that coveted million. Public interest now centered in the camp of his adversary. But it was necessary to find Suzanne. And they did not find her, nor did she escape. Consequently, it must be admitted, Arsène Lupin had won the first hand. But the game was not yet decided. The most difficult point remained. Mademoiselle Gerbois is in his possession, and he will hold her until he receives 500,000 francs. But how and where will such an exchange be made? For that purpose, a meeting must be arranged, and then what will prevent Monsieur Gerbois from warning the police, and in that way effecting the rescue of his daughter, and at the same time keeping his money? The professor was interviewed, but he was extremely reticent. His answer was,
"I have nothing to say."
"And Mademoiselle Gerbois?"
"The search is being continued."
"But Arsène Lupin has written to you?"
"No."
"Do you swear to that?"
"No."
"Then it is true. What are his instructions?"
"I have nothing to say."
Then the interviewers attacked Monsieur Detinan and found him equally discreet.
"Monsieur Lupin is my client, and I cannot discuss his affairs," he replied with an affected air of gravity.
These mysteries served to irritate the gallery. Obviously, some secret negotiations were in progress. Arsène Lupin had arranged and tightened the meshes of his net, while the police maintained a close watch day and night over Monsieur Gerbois. And the three and only possible denouements, the arrest, the triumph, or the ridiculous and pitiful abortion, were freely discussed. But the curiosity of the public was only partially satisfied, and it was reserved for these pages to reveal the exact truth of the affair. On Monday, March 12th, Monsieur Gerbois received a notice from the Crédit Foncier. On Wednesday, he took the 1 o'clock train for Paris. At 2 o'clock, 1,000 banknotes of 1,000 francs each were delivered to him. Whilst he was counting them, one by one, in a state of nervous agitation, that money which represented Suzanne's ransom, a carriage containing two men stopped at the curb a short distance from the bank. One of the men had grey hair and an unusually shrewd expression, which formed a striking contrast to his shabby makeup. It was Detective Ganimard, the relentless enemy of Arsène Lupin. Ganimard said to his companion, Folenfant,
"In 5 minutes we will see our clever friend Lupin. Is everything ready?"
"Yes."
"How many men have we?"
8. 2 of them on bicycles."
"Enough, but not too many. On no account must Gerbois escape us. If he does, it is all up. He will meet Lupin at the appointed place, give 500,000 in exchange for the girl, and the game will be over."
"But why doesn't Gerbois work with us? That would be the better way, and he could keep all the money himself."
"Yes, but he is afraid that if he deceives the other, he will not get his daughter."
"What other?"
"Lupin."
Ganimard pronounced the word in a solemn tone, somewhat timidly, as if he were speaking of some supernatural creature whose claws he already felt.
"It is very strange," remarked Folenfant judiciously, "that we are obliged to protect this gentleman contrary to his own wishes."
"Yes, but Lupin always turns the world upside down," said Ganimard mournfully.
A moment later, Monsieur Gerbois appeared and started up the street. At the end of the Rue des Capucines, he turned into the boulevards, walking slowly and stopping frequently to gaze at the shop windows.
"Much too calm, too self-possessed," said Ganimard. "A man with 1,000,000 in his pocket would not have that air of tranquillity."
"What is he doing?"
"Oh, nothing, evidently. But I have a suspicion that it is Lupin." "Yes, Lupin!"
At that moment, Monsieur Gerbois stopped at a newsstand, purchased a paper, unfolded it, and commenced to read it as he walked slowly away. A moment later, he gave a sudden bound into an automobile that was standing at the curb. Apparently, the machine had been waiting for him as it started rapidly away, turned at the Madeleine, and disappeared.
"Nom de nom!" cried Ganimard. "That's one of his old tricks!"
Ganimard hastened after the automobile around the Madeleine. Then he burst into laughter. At the entrance to the Boulevard Malherbe, the automobile had stopped and Monsieur Gerbois had alighted.
"Quick, Folenfant, the chauffeur. It may be the man Ernest."
Folenfant interviewed the chauffeur. His name was Gaston. He was an employee of the automobile cab company. 10 minutes ago, a gentleman had engaged him and told him to wait near the newsstand for another gentleman.
"And the second man, what address did he give?" asked Folenfant.
"No address. Boulevard Malherbe, Avenue de Messine, Double Bois. That is all."
But during this time, Monsieur Gerbois had leaped into the first passing carriage.
"To the Concorde station, Metropolitan," he said to the driver.
He left the underground at the Place du Palais Royal, ran to another carriage, and ordered it to go to the Place de la Bourse. Then a second journey by the underground to the Avenue de Villiers, followed by a third carriage drive to number 25 Rue Clapeyron. Number 25 Rue Clapeyron is separated from the Boulevard de Batignolles by the house which occupies the angle formed by the two streets. He ascended to the first floor and rang. A gentleman opened the door.
"Does Monsieur Datinon live here?"
"Yes, that is my name. Are you Monsieur Gerbois?"
Yes.
I was expecting you. Step in.
As Monsieur Gerbois entered the lawyer's office, the clock struck 3. He said,
I am prompt to the minute. Is he here?
Not yet.
Monsieur Gerbois took a seat, wiped his forehead, looked at his watch as if he did not know the time, and inquired anxiously,
Will he come?
Well, monsieur, replied the lawyer, that I do not know, but I am quite as anxious and impatient as you are to find out. If he comes, he will run a great risk, as this house has been closely watched for the last 2 weeks. They distrust me.
They suspect me, too. I am not sure whether the detectives lost sight of me or not on my way here.
But you were.
It wouldn't be my fault, cried the professor quickly. You cannot reproach me. I promised to obey his orders, and I followed them to the very letter. I drew the money at the time fixed by him, and I came here in the manner directed by him. I have faithfully performed my part of the agreement. Let him do his.
After a short silence, he asked anxiously,
He will bring my daughter, won't he?
I expect so.
But you have seen him?
I? No, not yet. He made the appointment by letter, saying both of you would be here, and asking me to dismiss my servants before 3 o'clock and admit no one while you were here. If I would not consent to that arrangement, I was to notify him by a few words in the Echo de France. But I am only too happy to oblige Monsieur Lupin, and so I consented.
How will this end?
Moaned Monsieur Gerbois. He took the banknotes from his pocket, placed them on the table, and divided them into 2 equal parts. Then the 2 men sat there in silence. From time to time, Monsieur Gerbois would listen. Did someone ring? His nervousness increased every minute, and Monsieur Detinan also displayed considerable anxiety. At last the lawyer lost his patience. He rose abruptly and said,
He will not come. We shouldn't expect it. It would be folly on his part. He would run too great a risk.
And Monsieur Gerbois, despondent, his hands resting on the banknotes, stammered,
Oh, mon Dieu, I hope he will come. I would give the whole of that money to see my daughter again.
The door opened. Half of it will be sufficient, Monsieur Gerbois. These words were spoken by a well-dressed young man, who now entered the room and was immediately recognized by Monsieur Gerbois as the person who had wished to buy the desk from him at Versailles. He rushed toward him.
Where is my daughter? My Suzanne!
Arsène Lupin carefully closed the door, and while slowly removing his gloves, said to the lawyer,
My dear maître, I am indebted to you very much for your kindness in consenting to defend my interests. I shall not forget it.
Monsieur Detinol murmured,
But you did not ring. I did not hear the door.
Doors and bells are things that should work without being heard. I am here, and that is the important point.
My daughter, Suzanne, where is she?
Repeated the professor.
Mon Dieu, monsieur, said Lupin. What's your hurry? Your daughter will be here in a moment.
Lupin walked to and fro for a minute. Then, with the pompous air of an orator, he said,
Monsieur Gerbois, I congratulate you on the clever way in which you made the journey to this place.
Then, perceiving the 2 piles of banknotes, he exclaimed,
Ah, I see, the million is here. We will not lose any time. Permit me.
1 moment. Said the lawyer, placing himself before the table. Mademoiselle Gerbois has not yet arrived.
Well?
Is not her presence indispensable?
I understand. Arsène Lupin inspires only a limited confidence. He might pocket the 500,000 and not restore the hostage. Ah, monsieur, people do not understand me. Because I have been obliged by force of circumstances to commit certain actions a little out of the ordinary, my good faith is impugned. I, who have always observed the utmost scrupulosity and delicacy in business affairs. Besides, my dear monsieur, if you have any fear, open the window and call. There are at least a dozen detectives in the street.
Do you think so?
Arsène Lupin raised the curtain. I think that Monsieur Gerbois could not throw Ganimard off the scent. What did I tell you? There he is now.
It is possible,
exclaimed the professor.
But I swear to you
that you have not betrayed me. I do not doubt you. But those fellows are clever, sometimes. Ah, I can see Folenfant, and Grom, and Dieuzy, all good friends of mine. Monsieur Detinan looked at Lupin in amazement. What assurance! He laughed as merrily as if engaged in some childish sport, as if no danger threatened him. This unconcern reassured the lawyer more than the presence of the detectives. He left the table on which the banknotes were lying. Arsène Lupin picked up one pile of bills after the other, took from each of them 25 banknotes, which he offered to Monsieur Detinan, saying, "The reward of your services to Monsieur Gerbois and Arsène Lupin, you well deserve it."
"You owe me nothing," replied the lawyer.
"What? After all the trouble we have caused you?"
"And all the pleasure you have given me."
"That means, my dear monsieur, that you do not wish to accept anything from Arsène Lupin. See what it is to have a bad reputation." He then offered the 50,000 francs to Monsieur Gerbois, saying, "Monsieur, in memory of our pleasant interview, permit me to return you this as a wedding gift to Mademoiselle Gerbois." Monsieur Gerbois took the money, but said,
"My daughter will not marry."
"She will not marry if you refuse your consent, but she wishes to marry."
"What do you know about it?"
"I know that young girls often dream of such things, unknown to their parents. Fortunately, there are sometimes good genii like Arsène Lupin, who discover their little secrets in the drawers of their writing desks."
"Did you find anything else?" asked the lawyer. "I confess I am curious to know why you took so much trouble to get possession of that desk."
"On account of its historic interest, my friend. Although, despite the opinion of Monsieur Gerbois, the desk contained no treasure except the lottery ticket, and that was unknown to me, I had been seeking it for a long time. That writing desk of yew and mahogany was discovered in the little house in which Marie Valeska once lived in Boulogne, and on one of the drawers there is this inscription, dedicated to Napoleon I, Emperor of the French, by his very faithful servant, Mancion. And above it, these words, engraved with the point of a knife, 'To you, Marie.'"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.